wonder I can think at all. And my lack of education hasn't hurt me none. I can read the writing on the wall. Quote a throne.
Live from the Capitol Beer House, it's Picture This, Tampa Bay's call-in talk show devoted exclusively to photography, hosted by Jeff Donald and myself, Lou Donald. Not only are we live tonight, but we have a special guest tonight. So, Jeff, let's get started.
Yeah, we do. Well, first, I want to thank Paul Simon for being here tonight, for doing that piece live. It was really nice of you, Paul, to come on out here to Clearwater and do that piece for us. So if you're not here at the Capitol, you just missed a live performance from Paul. He'll be doing some later on. So be sure and head on down to the Capitol Beer House to catch Paul Simon tonight. But our special guest is Jim Caldwell. And Jim and I have known each other for a few years. Jim, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you so much. I cannot believe you got Paul Simon. I mean, yeah. This is incredible.
Yeah. Yeah, well, only here in downtown Clearwater at the Capitol Beer House would this happen, that you'd have Paul Simon.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan.
Like that. Yeah, me too. But he'll be sticking around for a while, so come on down. You got time. Catch one of Tony's 32 draft beers, craft draft beers, or he's got some bottle beer too. So, or get a snack next door at Tony's Pizzeria. Great pizza. Get it by the slice or what have you. So we're here. If you've got a question for me, Jim, Lou, or Paul Simon, we're taking questions for Paul tonight. Call us at 727-441-3000 or toll free 866-826-1340, or if you'd rather email us, email picturethis.questions@gmail.com. And we've already got a question tonight, so we'll get to that in a minute. But thanks, Lou. You've got a feature tonight. What are you going to be talking about?
Well, we're going to talk about a photographer and his website. It's mitchdobrowner.com, MitchDobrowner.com.
Cool.
And he is the winner of the Sony 2012 World Photography Awards, the Diris d'Or winner.
Yeah.
I don't know what that means. It's in French.
Yeah. There's got to be somebody French here that knows it, but yeah, that's okay.
Maybe they can correct my pronunciation. But
probably.
He was inspired by Ansel Adams and Minor White as a young man. Got a grant from Canon as a young man in his late teens, early 20s, traveled around the Southwest,
Okay. Settled
in Southern California, went about his business, and at the age of probably mid-50s, family was raised, and he'd been successful in his business, and everybody in his family said, "Dad, pick your cameras up again."
Cool.
And he started in 2005. And just some amazing black and whites. He's a storm chaser a little bit. But some other stuff, when you click on his website, you'll see some incredible, not only weather with the storms, but landscapes, urban, done in a fresh new way where he's showing just this wide-angle view of, you know, Los Angeles with weather over
huge
it.
Huge storms.
Just an amazing photographer and well worth looking at and getting inspired.
You know, isn't that what your kids said? Well, actually, your grandkids said to you, "Grandpa, pick up your cameras again," and that's what you're doing here?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay. So, very good. That sounds like a great website. I'll have the links to that posted on our Facebook page, which is facebook.com/picturethisradioshow. We'll get those up for you tomorrow. Normally at this point, I do a little segment about this week in photo history, but I'm going to bypass this week because I got a cool new toy this week. And that doesn't happen too often, but the UPS lady dropped off a Ricoh GR Digital 4 camera. And I got to tell you, this is one of the slickest little pocket cameras I have ever shot with. Here, hold this, Jim.
Oh, that is solid.
Does that feel like a real camera?
That feels like a real camera.
It is. It's a magnesium body.
I was going to say that.
Yeah, it's all metal.
Yeah.
It is all metal.
That is not a cheap.
Nope, Nope. That could take some knocks, probably. Mm-hmm. It's got a 3-inch LCD screen on the back. It's got a hot shoe.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, and this year, all of our guests are getting a free copy of that. But unfortunately, it's only
Paul Simon and a free camera.
Yeah. Doesn't get any better than that tonight. But it is really a great little pocket camera. It's probably not for everybody, though. It doesn't have a zoom lens. And everybody goes, what? Doesn't have a zoom lens? It has a fixed 28 millimeter, but it's extremely fast. It's an f1.9 lens. And it's really set up for people that are serious about their photography. And in particular, a lot of street photography people have adopted this camera. And it's about at the end of its life.
Does this shoot RAW as well?
It shoots RAW. Shoots JPEG, doesn't shoot both. You have to make one or the other. It won't do both, but it is really a nice camera. I've been playing with it for about 3 or 4 days. Anything you could almost want. I really have a very short want list on a camera, and I'm a, you know, having been in the business, having sold cameras, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I think this is really cool. Mm-hmm. Even like, you know, and I've had Canon GR, the GR series, since day one. It's even got the removable ring. It's got attachments you can add. So if you want a 21 millimeter lens, you can go wider. Just don't have to go any closer. So, but it is what it is. It's a really slick camera. It's selling in Canada right now for like $299.
Well,
and in this country, when it got over here, it was a $799 camera, I think. And so I suspect they're going to get closed out here soon. I'm going to keep a watch on it, and when the price drops, I'll let people know. But boy, what a nice pocket camera! So that's my little segment. So with that out of the way, we'll answer this question right away, and then we'll get to talking with you, Jim. One of our listeners, because this is kind of off topic, but it is, it's photography. One of our listeners, Dennis, has sent us an email with a picture, and he says, I saw this photo on Saturday. The caption said it was captured with a nighttime filter. I'm not familiar with this one. Any ideas? And Jim, you can probably see that. Lou, I'll flip that around for you. You can see that. I know what I suspect it could be, but any takers?
I don't use much in the way of filters anymore. I do everything post-processing.
Yeah, not so. Since the film era.
Yeah, neutral density and polarizers.
Well, I would think a neutral density could well have delivered that, mm-hmm. but wouldn't necessarily give the reds in that.
No, it wouldn't change.
Yeah, like that. Could be one of those double polarizers. Like
could be a red-blue double polarizer. It could also be what we used to call an enhancing filter, which would enhance the reds.
The reds. The other thing would be, you know, in the in cinematography, which I was involved in on the video side, we used to have what we called nighttime filters, which because, you know, you would see these movie scenes that looked like they were shot at night.
Day for night filters.
Yeah, it was basically a day for night. I'm almost wondering if somebody hasn't adapted a day for night filter, and it would do some strange things on the other colors, because the idea was it would turn things kind of monochrome, and they would put the actors and actresses in monochrome kind of costumes. But if you had a brightly colored flower, I have a suspicion a day for night filter might very well accomplish that.
He didn't say what the original color of the flower was.
No, but it's some kind of water lily, you know, so we'll see. Dennis, I don't have the exact answer for you, but I do promise you I'll look into this over this week. And I know Dennis, so I'll try to get him the answer. So, let me take a minute and introduce Jim Caldwell to the audience. Jim and I have known each other for a few years. We first met, actually, on a Scott Kelby Worldwide Photo Walk.
That's correct, yes.
In Palm Harbor.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And Jim and I have become friends. You do a series of podcasts. And
just celebrated a third anniversary.
Third anniversary of doing podcasts. And you have a partner in your endeavors, and I'm struggling to remember his name.
Fred Rogers.
Mr. Rogers. Well, we won't go into that, but you and Fred have been at this for 3+ years.
That's
and,
correct.
And I've been on your podcast, I think, two or three times.
At least three, and coming up with maybe four.
Well, we're talking about doing another one, yes. and maybe you'll get Lou and I on.
Sounds good.
That would be interesting.
I'll supply the beer.
Yeah, there you go. So
now, you think you could talk Paul into coming then, too?
Paul
Simon.
Oh, yeah. Well, maybe we could have a reunion with Art Garfunkel. We'll get Paul and Art on your show.
There we go.
Yeah. So that'll have something
to listen
to. It
might give us a few extra listeners.
I would think so. But we've talked about a number of things over the years on your podcast. But most notably, recently, you know, you and your wife and I, we had lunch over in Palm Harbor. And you've started some travel things, which I'm really excited about.
Yes.
So I figured I would ask you, where have you been most recently?
Well, just back in March, I was in Iceland.
And?
We didn't want to, we got kind of tired of the warm, hot weather here, so we wanted something a little bit different.
Iceland might be the place to go.
Yeah, now we had invited Tim Vollmer on our podcast.
Right.
He's from Germany and currently lives in Iceland. So between Tim and I, we arranged a workshop.
Nice photo tour.
Yeah. We had about 10 days there, and it was just absolutely wonderful. We billed this as a Northern Lights Farewell to the Glaciers tour.
Yeah, that's about what it is.
So we were afraid that we got in there, and we had overcast skies. It was rainy, you know, early March.
Yeah.
We were afraid maybe we weren't going to see any Northern Lights once we got in there.
Yeah, well.
Fortunately, the skies cleared after about the third day. We got two nights. We got the Northern Lights.
Very cool. Very cool. But so you had how many people on your trip?
We had 10 people. 10 people signed up.
You know, that's a nice mix for teaching and traveling. You know, so many of these tours are like, you know, they bill themselves as photography tours, and they're 25, 30 people. And it's really not a lot of learning going on and a whole lot of just you're on your own because everybody's in separate vehicles and all that kind of stuff.
We put a cap at 10 people, and there was two instructors, myself and Tim Vollmer.
Right.
And we ran a bus, so everybody was together.
Yeah.
And it just worked out great. We're planning another one next March.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
And I've been fairly far north, up to Churchill, Manitoba, and those kind of things.
Now, that's one place I want to go.
Yeah.
Polar bears.
Well, then we need to do a trip.
There you go.
But Churchill, Manitoba, and I've been there towards the end of June, which are the longest days in the Northern Hemisphere.
Right.
So you were there when?
In March.
March.
Yes.
So you had
End of February, 1st of March.
So you had fairly long days, too.
Somewhat, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we had actually good weather. They've been having unseasonably warm weather right now. And before we arrived, as I said, it was 6 weeks of almost solid rain and overcast skies. So we were a bit concerned.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's always a thing on a trip, and that falls back on the guides to be able to kind of pick things up, keep the pace going, and keep the morale up. So, you know.
But everything turned out right.
Bring your guitar, sing lots of kumbaya songs, you know. So, all right.
I don't think they'd want to hear that.
No, all right.
Well, maybe from Tim, not from me.
Well, yeah. Well, Paul will be coming in a minute.
Yeah, we'll bring Paul in,
his interlude. So that's Iceland. Now, you and I talked, it's at least been a year.
Yes.
About your Mongolia expeditions. I mean, I wouldn't even call Mongolia a tour. That's got to be like an expedition, isn't it?
Yeah, I guess you could call it an expedition. It was quite primitive.
Yeah.
We were out in the middle of the Gobi Desert, middle of nowhere. We were living in the Gers.
Right.
In the Mongolian Gers.
That's like a yak hut or something, right?
Yes, it was. But very, very interesting. I wouldn't hesitate to go back to Mongolia.
Really?
It's a very, very interesting place, yes. And I think it's going to change very quickly because even while we were there, they were laying beds through the Gobi, which are within the next year or two will be major highways. So.
Oh, wow. Isn't that something?
Yeah, I hate to see that happen. But
so, challenges in the Gobi, I mean, that's not like being here in Clearwater or Tampa. How did you recharge your batteries? How do you do that kind of stuff? Because I'm assuming electricity is not just, oh, hey, there's a...
There's one, a plug over there.
Yeah, there's a plug to my yak hut here.
Well, believe it or not, they actually had electricity.
Yeah.
So they had solar
okay.
power that they could bring in and charge
that's
batteries.
Cool. That's cool.
And they had inverters. So
yeah.
They
so in the vehicles.
Well, the vehicles had them as well.
These the inverters,
old
yeah.
Russian, they look like Volkswagens. I can't even remember the names of these things. Solid. It was just unbelievable what they put these through. In fact, we had one point and he couldn't start it, and he reaches the seat behind me, pulls out a crank, and I'm not making this up. He went out in front of it and actually cranked it like an old Model T.
Yeah, yeah. Well, so, whatever it takes in Mongolia, I guess, to get the tour going. That's something.
And you never know what you're going to run into in a Gobi. We ran into a bunch of Englishmen that had golf clubs out, and they were actually hitting golf balls and then driving to their golf ball, and they were crossing the Gobi Desert.
Golfing it.
Yes.
Golfing it.
Golfing across the Gobi.
I'm sure there's a website for that.
At the risk of irate callers that would figure that they're English golfing across the Gobi.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Only. But... So when you're at your encampments for the night,
mm-hmm.
Did they run off of generators? Or
yes, yeah, yeah, they would turn a generator on, so we would
be able to charge
the batteries. Yeah,
you know, that's always been, you know, and even when I was in Africa and leading tours to Africa in the 80s and early 90s, which was still definitely the film era.
Mm-hmm.
The recharging of batteries wasn't a big deal for the photographers. But that was in the early era of the video, and it was surprising to me the number of people that were shooting amateur video at that time.
Yes.
Not so much VHS, but the 8mm had come along, and there were always about half the people would have 8mm video cameras, mm-hmm. and their biggest concern was charging up their batteries. And, you know, so we had to accommodate that in the vehicles.
Yeah, I was in Africa in 1990, and mm-hmm. I was shooting video
yeah.
primarily then,
yeah.
and yeah, that was a concern.
Yeah, yeah, it really was. But so what kind of pictures did you come back with from? Well, you've been to Mongolia several times.
No, just one time.
Oh, okay.
I was actually supposed to go back. I won an international photo competition and was invited back, but it only included the trip once I got there.
Right.
And the airfare and everything to get there is so expensive that I decided not to go. And
oh, yeah.
We ended up going to the Amazon instead.
Well, there you go.
So,
there you go.
So from this dry climate to the hot and muggy Amazon.
Yeah. Yeah, well, so what kind of pictures did you come back with from Mongolia?
In Mongolia, there's not a lot of wildlife there. I mean, they do have the eagles, which we, the eagle hunters up in the, they're actually Kazakh hunters up in the northwestern part of Mongolia. Primarily what I did was time-lapse at night. The stars there are just incredible and no light pollution whatsoever.
Yeah.
So I did a lot of time-lapse stuff at night, which means I didn't get a whole lot of sleep. But
but yeah, that would be incredible, because that's one of the, you know, even in the trips that we've led recently to like Yellowstone and some of these areas, it's amazing the light pollution in the United States.
Yes.
And
I know our national parks are trying to eliminate that, but
there's no
still got the cities around, and there's nothing you can do about it.
There's no getting around it. But so a lot of nighttime stuff,
mm-hmm.
And I suspect a lot of scenery, because I would assume the Gobi Desert has lots of sand.
Yeah,
so.
And it all looks the same. I mean, you could point the camera anywhere, and it all looks the same.
but the way that the light plays on the sand, the shadows, and you know, that's got to be something pretty amazing.
Yes,
and then of course the golfers coming through.
And the golfers, that was interesting.
The British golfing through.
And we also we went into a cave, and any place else you would go, like in France, I guess, has the hieroglyphs.
Yeah, they've got the cave paintings.
Well, they've
and all
got
that.
One there that they're supposed to be 20, 30,000 years old.
Oh, wow.
But it's in the middle of nowhere. You have to climb up the mountain to get into this cave. There's a caretaker that lives near there in a ghare, nothing else around. And these paintings are just out there in the open for anybody to. I'm surprised they're still there, quite frankly.
Yeah, that Well, and it's probably only survived because of the dry climate and things. You know,
more than likely, yes.
Yeah, that's amazing. I'm going to hand out the phone numbers again if anyone would like to call in with questions for us. It's 727-441-3000 or toll-free 866-826-1340. And if you have a question, email us at picturethis.questions@gmail.com. And we're here at the Capitol Beer House with Jim Caldwell. Lou, do you have any questions for Jim?
Well,
kind of monopolizing this conversation.
You know, there's a lot of listeners and members of FLCCP that travel.
Mm-hmm.
And with the experience that you've had, I wonder if you could pick one place that you were going to go to. There's no limits. Just where would you like to go?
Antarctica. There's no hesitation. That's the top of my bucket list right now.
Really?
Yeah, I'm dying to go to Antarctica. And I can't even tell you why. It's just because it's remote, exotic, and I think there are some probably terrific photo opportunities there with the penguins, the emperors, and the
penguins. I mean, I'm not going to get into the politics of it, but, there's certainly big pieces of ice shelves that are falling off of Antarctica.
Well, yeah, it's kind of like our farewell to the glaciers. It might be farewell to Antarctica.
Well, the continent will still be there, but
the ice and
the way that we have seen pictures of the explorers 100 years ago, or it's not going to be the same.
Yep.
If you want to see that, it's now.
Everything is changing very, very rapidly, and
So Antarctica would be the top of your bucket list.
Yeah, for somebody who lives in Florida, Iceland, Antarctica, and I moved from Pennsylvania because I couldn't stand the cold.
Let me think about that. Well, you know, that's interesting. Now, you've only been to Africa once?
One time.
Really?
Kenya and Tanzania, yes.
Yeah.
I would love to go back to Africa.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, see, that's, I think it was Hemingway that said, if you can only visit one other place, visit Africa twice.
Or yes.
Something to that effect. You know, so he was trying to tell you how really special that is. And that's kind of my bucket list. Mm-hmm. Is I haven't been to Kenya, Tanzania, that East Africa in probably about 20 years now.
Well, it was 1990 when I was last there, so it's been a while for me.
Yeah, Lou, what's on your bucket list?
Well, Africa would be it.
Yeah.
I've never been there.
Yeah,
and to go to places like Kenya, Tanzania. Even parts of South Africa.
Well, we'll have to talk to Nori. Nori's in our audience this evening. She's with Cruise Planners.
Yeah, right.
And we have to get a cruise to Kenya and Tanzania going. You're going to work on that. Yeah, okay, cool. But Nori's actually working with us. We've got a cruise plan. Not for this year. This year's already booked. Can't even do it. 2014. We're leading a cruise up to New England.
Mm.
And New England and Bay of Fundy, New Brunswick, and all that kind of stuff.
I'm actually heading up there in July.
Yeah.
Well, into Maine.
Well, we're going to see fall colors.
Yeah, I won't see it in July. We're hoping to see puffins.
Yeah, puffins are cool.
Yeah, we booked a cruise out to the Machias Seal Island.
Yeah, yeah.
So if the weather cooperates with us, maybe we had the same luck we had with the Northern Lights.
You just never know.
And I never know.
Are you a birder?
I love birds, yeah. In fact, that's what really got me back into photography.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I did not know that.
Yes. It was bird photography. It was a book I read by Art Morris.
Yeah.
Who at the time I didn't realize was a Floridian.
Yeah.
And
well, he wasn't originally, but...
No.
He's from
New York.
New Jersey, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, Artie's a little bit of a friend. I don't know him real well, but I first met him in Cape May, New Jersey. I was with a fella who was kind of my mentor. His name's Ron Austin, who was a big-time bird photographer in the 50s and 60s. And back then, everything was mostly black and white because the color film was so slow.
Yep.
And what he used to do was he had all of these bird pictures in color. And he was using Hasselblad, like 500 Cs and this kind of stuff. And nobody could figure out how he was doing it. Well, what he used to do was he was a park ranger. And he would capture these birds. And he would build these elaborate dioramas in his basement. And he would put these birds in the diorama. And he had... He had these high-powered strobes, and he would light these things up, the birds flying and everything else. And people were, I mean, nobody...
So that's how that was done.
So nobody had seen stuff like this. And so Ron was kind of my mentor in my early days, and we a couple times, we didn't really travel together, but we would meet up at like Cape May for the migrations and stuff. And one migration, Artie was Cape May, and Ron was this real gruff, cigar-smoking kind of guy. He was like, that's Arthur Morris over there. I go, really? Because Arthur Morris was kind of a hero of mine.
Yeah.
And it was kind of interesting. And he was demoing, testing one of the first Wimberley...
gimbal heads?
Gimbals.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And that's how I met Artie. And we kind of stayed in touch over the years. And, you know, he was a friend of Ron Austin. And everybody kind of knew Ron because he was this guy. But by that time, he was kind of fading. Things had passed him by. Shooting everything as a diorama with flash in the 90s wasn't happening anymore. But, you know, but it is what it is. But
well, I've run into Artie a few times in the field. And a friend of mine works with Artie now, James Shadle. If you know Jim Shadle.
Yeah, I've talked to him on the phone. We've talked about some things. You know, we had talked about, well, some birding things and such. But, yeah, Jim runs a cool, the hoop-de-doo.
The Alifi, yeah.
Yeah, he does some stuff
on
the
Alifi. Got to get him on my podcast again because we always get a free trip out to the Alifi.
Yeah. Those listeners aren't familiar with that. It's changing a little over the last couple of years, but... the spoonbill population,
right.
Originally the big nesting habitat for roseate spoonbills was down in Florida Bay, which is in the Everglades.
Mm-hmm.
And for really reasons that are unknown, the birds decided not to nest in Florida Bay quite so much, and they started nesting further north, and they moved into Tampa Bay at the mouth of the Alafaya on a couple of spoil islands, basically. And James Shadle and his son,
Blake.
Mm-hmm. I was just searching for that. Thank you. And they, in the spring, which is pretty much over now, we're into May. That season's pretty much over. But, March, April, they take their pontoon boat, the Hoop-De-Doo 2,
mm-hmm.
and take tours out into Tampa Bay.
Well, it's actually the Hoop-De-Doo. It was, the original was the Hoopty, and this is Hoopty number two, Hoopty two.
What do I
know? It's the French.
Yeah, it's that French thing again. But
you know, the roseates now are moving up, I think, last
Sarasota.
Year. Well, they're actually here in the Spoil Islands right here north of Clearwater by Honeymoon Island. For last year, for the first time, there was a couple.
Yeah.
I didn't know if you knew that I am... last year passed my Florida Master Naturalist.
Oh, no, I wasn't aware of that.
And it was one of the groups that they were talking about with the Audubon.
Yeah.
In fact, they were excited because they seem to be moving even further north. They haven't been there since maybe turn of the century.
Yeah. Well, it seems the bulk of the population has now moved into Sarasota Bay.
Yep.
So, but it varies. Water levels change. Temperatures change. So, you know, from year to year.
The food supply.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's all variable. But anyway. Lou, you have a... Yeah, this has probably gotten really boring for half the people listening. I'm not sure.
In French.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, to kind of get back a little bit to the photography part of it.
Oh, photography.
When you travel, what lenses do you travel with?
Well, it depends. Mm-hmm. It depends on what I'm doing. When I was in Iceland, for example... I knew I wouldn't need my big 500.
Yeah.
There was no reason to take that. So I had a 100 to 400 and almost never used it.
Right.
Most everything that when we were there was landscape, so we resorted more to the wide-angle lenses, 28 yeah. to 135, 17 to 35.
Yeah.
So when I go up to Maine here in a few weeks, I will be taking the 500 with me, although I understand that it's not a good idea to take it out to the Machias Island, that the little blinds they have, the little panels,
right.
They're not very large.
Yeah, so you don't have the room to...
you don't really, and they're cramped. I guess these are like 4 by 8 foot, and they may cram 4 or 5 people in there. So.
Oh, at least. You'd be surprised.
But I'm hoping to go up to Baxter also for moose, the 500 should come in handy there.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's a nice assortment of lenses. And
the best thing is to take the lenses. You know, you don't want to take too much because of packing and carrying all this, so you take what you need for that particular trip.
Well, how do you get those lenses on the airlines today?
I have a wife. It's my Sherpa.
Yeah. She has to.
We crammed the 500
in her purse.
Yeah.
Does it fit in her purse?
No, we put her in her travel bag and pack stuff around it. And then I have either a vest that I pack lenses in. And right now they still don't. Hopefully this doesn't change. Hope I don't give anything away. But they don't count that as carry-on.
That's right.
It's still classified, I guess, as clothing or coat.
Whatever you wear on your person, you can pretty much get on the plane.
So I have what's it called, a vested interest vest, really nice vest, and you can cram a lot of stuff in there.
That's you're not the only person that, that you know, Artie travels a lot. He talks about
Artie's
it
the one that actually told me about it.
Yeah.
And when I called the guy and told him that Artie recommended it, he actually asked me for my size and did a custom one for me.
Yeah, well, those vests, Scott Kelby has talked about it that you know, if you need to travel with your equipment, I mean, you're really not going to check $5,000, $6,000, $8,000, $10,000, $12,000 lens. And it's not so I mean, there's two concerns. One is something happens to it. They drop it, they smash it, you get there. So whether it's covered by your insurance, the airline's certainly not going to pay off on it. They're going to pay off at that minimal, you know, dollar per pound, you know, thing. So you're not going to get much there. So you'd better have it insured. But the other side of it is you need it when you get there. What do I do now? And, you know, so can you rent it? And in these exotic locations, there's nothing.
Well, you can ship it ahead
in
some instances.
Yeah,
and also understand that some of the rental places that you can rent the equipment and they will ship it to the location. But that's provided you know where you're going to be.
Yeah,
and you've got somebody that can receive it.
Yeah, and the hotel's willing to do that.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah. Somebody's got to sign for that.
I have never done that, but I know that is a possibility.
Well, back when I used to do video, I used to do a lot of that.
Yeah,
and. Simply because of the weight of it, you couldn't carry it on your person. Yeah, here's my 53-pound video camera that I'm wearing on my neck. So we used to do a lot of that shipping FedEx, and domestic was never a problem, but boy, international, nobody wanted to sign for anything. But so
we had that problem. We did a film. This was before video. We were doing a film down in Jamaica.
Oh, yeah.
And we brought in something like 6 big Pelican cases full of equipment, and what a hassle that was.
Yeah. Well, and then you have issues with customs and everything else.
Oh, too. That's where we had issues.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Well, yeah, and I mean, that's why, I mean, I didn't deal with it a lot, but there are places, there are people that are called expediters, mm-hmm. and that's their job, is to get that stuff through customs. You pay them big bucks to get your high-end gear through it so that your schedule all still clicks.
For what we went through, it'd be worth every penny, I'm sure.
Yeah. Understood indeed. So the lenses are really varied on the location and things. What kind of camera bag do you like to travel with? You know, you mentioned a vest. Do you just shoot from a vest, or you use?
No, I usually use the vest just to transport the gear there. Well, it depends on where I'm going. Most of the places are, if they're hot, the vest isn't that comfortable to wear out. So right now I'm using a belt, and with it's adaptable. You can put pouches in it,
yeah,
and you can throw everything in those pouches. I think Think Tank. makes the belt.
Yeah, there's a couple of those. Teresa's got a nice belt system that she sometimes uses. I've never been a big fan of it, but I don't know. The older I get, you know, when I get to be your age.
Or I earned all these gray hairs here.
Or my brother's age. Wow, that boy. I hope I'm still taking pictures then.
I'm still young on the inside.
But so you don't use a camera bag much, really?
No, I have a backpack.
Yeah.
But again, I stuff everything in there, and as far as going out with it, I really don't use that much, so. And anyway, yeah, I find that the belts work great.
Work best for you, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I use the Black Rapid strap with the cameras.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Teresa's tried those. We have a lot of members.
Black, what does she think?
Black Rapid is certainly the most popular.
Yes, I love the straps.
Yeah. Well, and they make a model that's designed for women.
Yes, they do.
Because it's particularly cut around the bust line. And
anatomically correct.
Yeah, it's an anatomically correct strap. Mm-hmm. But
and they've got a newer one they just came out with. I guess it's about half the price, a little smaller, lighter for smaller cameras. Yeah, I think it's about $39 or something like that.
I use, and truthfully, I never found a sling strap I liked. We had lots of members using them, and I actually tried a Black Rapid, and you know, I don't mean to talk bad about these guys, but they're not a sponsor of the show, so I don't have a vested interest.
Yeah, they didn't give me any freedom.
Yeah.
So.
but this company called Sun Sniper, they're a German company, and they sent me a strap a couple years ago, and this is after I'd tried all these other ones, and I'm thinking, oh, one more sling strap. How many of these things am I going to have to try? Jeez, oh, Pete. So, and I'm using it to today. I mean, I did two photo walks today. And I'm using it to today. A couple things I really like about it. One is the way it attaches, it has never loosened once on a lens or anything I've screwed it onto. The actual swivel part is a real stainless steel ball bearing assembly with real races, real, and I mean, it is on there. Hmm. And I like the idea that it's stainless steel. It's not going to rust. It's not going to seize up. It's not going to be a problem. And the strap itself is nylon, but sewn through the center of it is a steel cable. Because I guess in Europe, or parts of Europe, people with razor knives, scissors.
I've heard parts of South America, too.
Yeah, they will cut the strap and it's gone. When you use their straps, they actually, automatically, they give you $500 of camera loss insurance. That if one of their straps is cut and you lose your camera, they'll give you $500.
Well, next time we get together, you'll have to show me that.
Well, not only that. It's got like this bungee cord arrangement as part of the strap, and the steel still goes through it. It doesn't feel like it does on the other ones.
I'll be darned.
So yeah, when I come on and do it, I'll bring one of my shows on.
Yeah,
but it's called a Sun Sniper.
Yeah, Sun Sniper.
Yeah, they are really, really nice.
Two I were looking at. The other one's not a sling type strap, but it was this cotton carrier. Are you familiar with
it? Cotton carrier.
We had somebody in one of our workshops showed up with one of this, but it looked like something from Iron Man. I mean, it was it looked very military.
And
very uncomfortable.
Yeah. Well, I've seen some vests like that, too. Mm, I mean, I've seen. And for me, it's even hard to find a decent photo vest anymore. That's a real market niche for somebody that wants to build a product. I mean, the company that you mentioned that builds them for Artie, builds them for you.
Yeah, the vested interest.
Vested interest.
Yeah.
But truthfully, as a shooter's vest that I want to work out of, the thing is...
Yeah, it's too bulky, too hot.
Yeah.
Especially here in Florida.
Yeah. And... I use old Banana Republic vests back before Banana Republic got bought by Gap. And you can actually search on eBay and find people selling the old vests from 20 years ago, and that's what I keep buying. But I have found an alternative. Cabela's, the camping store.
Oh, sure. I buy a lot of stuff from Cabela's. Yeah.
They have a real nice vest that they bill, I think, as their safari vest. Mm. And it's a wonderful shooter's vest. And it's like $39.95. And it's like, well, that's pretty tough.
I'll check it out.
Yeah.
I'm still like the belts. But, in fact, it was Jason Hahn at Outdoor Photo Workshops that I do my workshops through that turned me on to those. So.
How's that going?
Very good.
Yeah. Because Jason's a local guy.
Yes, he is. And in fact, I met him through Jimmy Sale.
Oh, yeah.
James, so we met down in the Everglades.
And oh, that's cool. So where are you doing your workshops locally?
Well, I do workshops with Jason as he needs them.
Right.
We get more than X number of people, then he brings in additional.
Sure.
And he really brought me in to do the international workshops.
Oh, that's
so
cool.
So the one we did to Iceland was run through him.
Oh, okay.
And next year we're going to be doing one to Slovenia.
Really?
Yes. And there was in fact, the gentleman, again, was on our podcast, and he's a friend of Tim Vollmer.
Okay.
I guess this is all a community that goes around.
It's just about.
And so after we did the one with Tim, he contacted me and says, you got to come to Slovenia, so we're going to give it a shot.
So what are you going to shoot there?
Probably landscapes again.
Landscapes?
Yeah.
And some urban stuff?
No, it's going to be out. There's old medieval churches.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
and I guess you could call them castles.
Yeah.
Farmland and just some. It's right at the foothills of the Alps.
Yeah.
So there should be some. Beautiful landscapes.
Oh, yeah. What time of year? Do you have a date yet?
October is what we're thinking of, 2014.
14. You're
not this
year out, too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'd have to. Wow. That should be exciting.
Yep.
Yeah. You'll have to show us.
I want to get back to Costa Rica again, too.
yeah. Well, you get around. You know, when I did the promotion on this on Facebook and all this fun stuff, you know, we talked about you being an international travel photographer. So Central America, Costa Rica, what do you shoot down there?
Down in Peru. Costa Rica, I have a friend that I've been going down there for about 18, 19 years.
Yeah.
And a friend of mine is a guide, Jorge Fernandez.
Mm-hmm.
Jorge lives just outside of San Jose.
Right.
And a terrific birder. This guy can actually call the birds in. Plus, he's known as the medicine man down there. He really knows the plants. His grandfather, I believe it was a shaman.
Oh, wow.
And the pharmaceutical companies tend to hire him to take them out into the savannah looking for potential
plants
for medications.
Be synthesized into some kind of medication.
In fact, the gentleman I met last year in Peru, who's a pharmacologist or pharmacist.
Yeah.
A researcher.
Sure.
And he was taking bullet ants when I saw him in Peru and putting them. Now, I don't know if anybody knows what a bullet ant is, but these are supposed to be one of the most painful ant bites you can have. These things are about an inch long.
Oh, man.
And he was putting them on the farm and purposely letting them sting his arm in order to get an idea of the effects, the toxic effects. He's studying toxic, the venoms.
Sure.
From insects, snakes, and he wanted to get a fertile lance. Well, three times you run into fertile lance in Costa Rica with Jorge. So I told him about Jorge, and now I understand he has hired Jorge to develop a plot of land down there where he can actually grow these plants. So,
jeez. Yes, not a hobby I'm likely to get involved in.
No, me neither.
Letting ants bite my arm. That sounds like fun. Come on now.
See, he was one brave dude.
Yeah, to say the least.
Jeez.
The things we encounter.
Yes.
I mean, that's really what Costa Rica is known as for some of the bird life.
Yes. So oh, yeah. We go down there for the resplendent quetzals. Or quetzal.
Yeah. That's a, you know, anybody that I know that goes down there, they all talk about going on the hunt for them,
right?
But few come back with any kind of images.
Well, Jorge's taken us twice to a place where they nest. We've actually gotten them nesting.
Oh, wow. So, that's amazing.
Yes.
Because so few people even see them.
Yep.
And your trips get to actually see a nest.
Well, 4 years ago, I got a picture of one, and they're supposed to be fruit and seed eaters.
Right.
And I got a picture, a close-up, with one with this huge grasshopper. And it turns out that apparently when they have young, they actually feed them insects.
Oh, wow.
So then
higher
young
protein,
develop,
probably, yeah, or something. So they grow faster.
Rapid growth, and,
yeah. That makes sense. Louie? Oh, he's going to have to read off his notes, yeah. Get your quad focals out and see what you can come up with.
My arm's not long enough anymore to be able to read this light.
You know, travel photography seems so romantic to people.
From the outside.
From the outside. That's what I was just going to ask. What's it really like?
It's a lot of work. I mean, you know, hours sitting in airports, planes canceled. We were down in Peru last year, and they canceled our flight and told us it was going to be 4 days before they could get us another flight out. So here we are in Lima, no hotel room. All the rooms are booked. We end up getting a seedy little place about a mile from the airport.
Yeah. They normally rent by the hour, probably.
Yes, and that's another reason travel insurance is good, because fortunately we had travel insurance and covered it. But it's sometimes not the travel, it is the destination.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Well, it's I mean, a lot of people, well, you probably had this experience, but, you know, one of the most shocking things when I would take people to East Africa was we typically flew into Nairobi, and you'd get off the plane, and a lot of times it would be late at night because of the time changes and, you know, planes and everything else. It typically tended to be pretty late at night, and you'd get your transfer to your hotel, and you get off your plane, and you walk through this place, and all you see are guys in camouflage with, like, M16s. And so you just went from, you know, Tampa International to JFK to all of a sudden you're seeing everybody. That's like, this is a I was instructed that a member of the group said, we don't call these third world nations anymore. These are developing nations. So, you know, in traveling to developing nations, you got to understand there's sometimes military there, and it's not what we're used to at home. We are not in the United States. The same rules don't apply.
Yep.
So
it is a little bit different when, I was in Honduras, and you fly into San Pedro Sula, and we had to catch another plane out to the island we were going to.
Yeah.
And you're in, you don't go through customs there. You go through customs at the destination.
No.
So you're in this holding tank with armed guards around you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
we had that in Africa. I think we were going from either from Tanzania to Kenya or vice versa, and we took a small plane.
Yeah.
And they made everybody get into this small room. They unpacked all of our luggage. They brought dogs in. And in the meantime, as you said, they had the soldiers standing outside the door holding the semi-automatics.
In Tanzania, on several, that's usually where we flew out of. We'd fly into Nairobi, spend a week there or so, and then cross over into Tanzania, and then fly out. Almost always, the radar, or the, not radar, excuse me, the X-ray machines were never working. So
we never saw an X-ray machine.
Yeah. Well, they were there, but, you know, I mean, you saw them.
Well, they had machines,
broken this week.
It was usually somebody eyeballing everything, going through.
So they would take us into a private room, one at a time, and they would open up your luggage. And so I used to warn people. I said, you know, they are going to take something out of your luggage. Do not raise a fuss. Let them take it. Okay? Otherwise, you will be in a jail in Tanzania, because there's no way you're going to win that argument. So they're like, what? I said, just trust me. And most of the time, it never happened. But on one trip, they had me in there. And I forget what he pulled out of my luggage. And he just looks right at me and slides this thing in his pocket. It's like, okay, No problem. See ya. You know, let me get on my plane. Thank you. And, you know, it's just what it was. You just, you know, this is not about the Bill of Rights. We're not in that country.
Well, we warn people, do not take pictures of the soldiers. Keep your cameras
away. Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was a big thing, too.
Just ignore them.
Don't even think about it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But that's traveling in a developing nation.
Yes.
But so you've got a couple trips coming up.
Yes. Yeah.
So
we're hoping. We plan next March back to Iceland.
Back to Iceland in March of 2014.
Yep.
So that's about a year.
Slovenia. Yeah, Slovenia, and
that's in the fall of 2014.
The fall of 2014. Yeah. Yes. And Tim wants to do a trip with me to Costa Rica. So we're talking about that possibly February.
Yeah. That's a good season, actually.
Yeah.
I used to lead trips to Belize, which is...
Belize is nice, yes.
Well, it's more my speed, because I speak English. And, for those of you that don't know where Belize is, it used, to, be called,
un poco español.
Used to be called British Honduras.
Honduras, that's right.
So, and it is...
Although there's a lot of Spanish spoken there, too.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. And Carib, you know. They have a dollar too. I mean, you can pay with the U.S. dollar.
Well, that's what Ecuador. Ecuador is nice too, because Ecuador is on the American dollar.
Yeah, so that makes things real convenient. But Belize is. But I have never been to Costa Rica, and being the birder that I am, that's really on my.
That surprises me. I thought you had been down there.
Not Costa Rica. Belize and Guatemala, and of course Mexico.
Yep.
But so is what it is. But we had we've always had great times in Belize, and
I enjoyed Belize.
I could go almost
the last
anywhere
time I did any underwater English. Photography was in Belize.
Second largest barrier reef in the world.
Yes, I wanted Belize to get reef. The whale shark. Unfortunately, it didn't show.
But. Yeah, and most people don't know that. You know, they all think about the. The Australian Barrier Reef, but Belize, if you're a diver, great place to go.
That's why I was in Honduras.
Yeah. Well, it was probably cheaper, too. I mean, Belize isn't that expensive, but great diving. But that's not me. I am not an underwater guy. I will leave that to...
I'm getting a little old for that now. I am.
David Dubilet. The geographic guy. I met him once or twice, and... That's my idea of underwater. I will look at David Dubilet's pictures.
Okay.
I can live vicariously through him. Any last questions, Lou? We're winding down here.
Yeah, we kind of covered. We usually ask someone the last question, what's in your camera bag? But we've kind of talked about that.
Yeah, we kind of covered that, didn't we? And I'm a little bit, in fact, it was not too far from here, right down here at the old Capitol Theater that I first met Rick Salmon.
Oh, yeah.
And Rick talked about that, you know, he doesn't really specialize in anything. He's a professional generalist. And that's when I decided, oh, well, it's okay. Then I don't really have to specialize. And so I love things that are a little bit different, like time-lapse, HDR.
Sure.
And so often I have things in my camera bag that other people wonder, what the heck's a photographer doing with that kind of stuff?
This is true.
Well, and that's something that I've always enjoyed about photography. There is just an unlimited possibility of what you can do.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I would have to say, you know, this is in the old film era, though, because, I mean, there's a reason for this. But probably the strangest thing that I used to carry was an actual compass.
I got a compass, yes.
Yeah, no. Well... I carry a compass too. I also make phone calls with my compass. And the reason I carried a compass was sunrises, sunsets.
Yep.
Now there are such
Well, great apps. Well, I can't remember the name of it.
Well, the one that I use the most is the Photographer's Ephemeris.
Ephemeris. That's the one I was trying to remember.
And for folks that aren't familiar with that, it's kind of like a cross of Google Earth and the U.S. Naval Observatory. It gives you sunrises, sunsets, moonrises, moonsets, anywhere in the world.
And Google Earth is a terrific resource, too.
It is.
I mean, even Maine going up there, I was able to check and see where the sunrise, the sunset, where the moon was going to be, where to stand.
Yep.
So
and so the photographer's ephemeris, and a lot of the people that are here today, I know Paul Simon included.
Yep.
He's been out with us occasionally for the sunrise and moonrise and moonsets that we do, and that's all courtesy of the photographer's ephemeris.
Well, you know, and that brings up a question.
Okay,
how much research do you really put in terms of time before you take one of these trips about what you're going to do there?
Usually a lot. I mean, there's so many good resources these days with the internet. You can find almost anything. I mean, go out to Flickr sites and other people's photo sites.
Oh, yeah.
See where they have taken pictures, things that I like, and mark those down. There's also another nice app that'll let you go out to locations and record the coordinates. You can take some pictures with your cell phone.
Yep.
And then come back later when the light is better. So, I do a lot of research beforehand, read books, and ask questions for people that have been to these locations.
Yeah. That's a big part of it is, and, being the guide, you've got to know a lot of this. But fortunately, it's not, because I've led trips, it's not just up to us. We rely on the locals to a large degree who really, if it weren't for them, these trips would almost be impossible.
Correct. In fact, in Maine, I'm hiring locals to the Machias, also in Baxter State Park.
Oh,
I got a guy hired for the, hopefully to get some moose and take us through the park. Because our time there is limited. He knows the spots. He knows the park.
Yeah. And that's what's, I'm not going to make this a plug, but, for several years, we've run trips to Yellowstone. And I used to live out there.
Yes, I love Yellowstone, too.
So I don't have to rely on local guides there. I lived out there for 4 years.
So you're telling me I've got a guide right here that can take me to Yellowstone.
Yeah. You need to come with me sometime.
Okay. Paul? But join us.
Yeah. No, we do good. We find bear every year. Wolves are tough. There's never any guarantee.
Wolves are one to think. It's a little Mar Valley. I'm not familiar with that area.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we've seen wolves from a distance, but never close enough that you could shoot.
I did a winter trip there once, too.
Oh,
that was amazing.
I would love to do another winter trip.
Again, in the snow and the ice.
Oh, yeah. Well, I like the snow and ice.
That was the coldest I'd ever been, Western Yellowstone. It dropped one night to 30 below zero.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll do that without a problem. Mm-hmm. But, I don't think these Floridians would have a problem with that.
Knowing you're going to leave
below. you can still wear your shorts, folks. Trust me.
Sure, yeah.
Trust me. Well, I think our time is about up. We need to, we're doing this live. We need to switch this back to the station. I know Cedric is anxiously waiting to play the NBC News. Jim, I can't thank you enough for being on the show.
It has been my pleasure, and I really appreciate you asking me on.
And I know Paul Simon's going to do another live piece here.
I'm excited.
Yeah, the audience will get a chance, the listening audience get a chance to hear a little bit of that. Lou, you got any last comments, and we'll be out of here.
Well, I think it's been a great time talking about travel photography and photography in general, and look forward to hearing more about what you do.
Good.
That's great.
Well, I appreciate it.
And Lou and I will be on your podcast. So
sounds great.
So from Picture This, Lou Donald, Jim Caldwell, this is Jeff Donald. Thanks for joining us this evening. And now I'm sure you'll have a Paul Simon interlude. Cedric, back to you, sir.
When I think back on all the crap I learned in high school, it's a wonder.
WTAN, Clearwater, Tampa Bay. WDCF, Dade City, Tampa Bay. WZHR, Zephyr Hills, Tampa Bay. Listen.
Worse than